Father, I come to you now in Jesus' name, Lord. God, I pray that you would work in this meeting right now through your word, God. I pray, Lord, just as John the Baptist said, less of me, Lord, and more of you, Father. And God, we want more of you today, God. We want more of your word, Lord. We want more of the plans that you have for us, Lord. We want more of your power to live this life. God, I pray that right now through the power of your Holy Spirit that you would speak into the life of every individual, that you would infuse them with power, that you would strengthen them within their inner being. And we thank you that your word works, and we believe in your word this morning, and we give you all the glory, for you alone deserve the glory. There's no one else that deserves any glory, for you are the Holy One, and we praise you, and we declare your goodness in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Last week, I started a new series called Unusual, and we're really speaking about that how God calls us to live in a world that is so stereotyped. He calls us to live an unusual life, and what's so unusual to us as Christ followers today and to the world today is actually, it's just so ordinary to God and too usual to God. In fact, when you look at the life of Jesus, people were totally blown away and in awe of who he was and what he did, but it was just who he was. And as Christ followers, as people who are devoted to God, we're living for God, everything that Jesus was able to do on this earth, in actual fact, we are able to do, because he says in John 14:12, he says, greater works will you do than I did. And so we're called to live an unusual life. And I believe that when I say it's unusual, I'm not saying it's weird and crazy out there. I'm just saying to experience the unusual blessing that God has, the unusual favor, the unusual power that God has for your life and for my life. Amen. And so we look at the word unusual, and what does it mean? It means to be uncommon. It means to be not, it's not usual. It's uncommon to our kind of ordinary day life. And so last week I made this statement, and this is kind of the thesis of our series, is that if we're going to, and unusual things, I've written this in our notes, is that unusual things happen when we live in an unusual way. Is that unusual things, we're going to experience what God has for us when we change the way of our, maybe our own thinking or our own living, and we start to live our life according to what, the way God has prescribed us to live. We're going to start experience unusual things happen into our life. And we spoke about unusual habits, and we spoke about the habit of putting God first and focusing on the first things that we do, because the first things that we do say a lot about us. And we spoke about putting God first in every area of our life. And I think that I pray that God challenged you in that message. If you weren't here, you can get that message on a CD in the bookshop after the service. And so in order for us to live this way that God is calling us, how do we do that? How are we going to live it? I believe God gives us the answer in Scripture. And in Romans chapter 12, verses 2, it says, take your everyday, ordinary life, your sleeping, eating, going to work, and walking around life, and place it before God as an offering. Embracing what God does for you is the best thing that you can do for him. So God is interested. This is what we need to know, is that God is interested in your everyday life. God is not just interested in your Sunday church attendance. God's interested in everyday life. You're walking around everything that you want, that you do in your everyday life. And so what happens is if we don't focus and we don't commit our everyday life to God, what the result of that is that we get influenced by everything else around us. Because look what the scripture says. It says, don't become so well adjusted to your culture that you fit into it without even thinking. How many of you know that the culture of this world is strong? And we got to be on guard. Paul said to Timothy, guard that which has been entrusted to you. And there's a responsibility on you and I, because this world's culture is strong, is that we have to guard what God has entrusted into us and deposited into us. And when we start to do that, we're not going to get dragged down. We're not going to get dragged down, because that's the enemy's plan, is that he'd drag you down, that your faith would be depleted, that you'd get caught up in the negative conversation, that you'd be caught up in what's going on all around us. But I'm here to say to you this morning, we are called to a higher life, to a higher calling, to a higher purpose, and we are not dictated by what is going on around the world. We are set our eyes on Jesus, and Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life for us. And so what do we got to do? He says, don't become so well adjusted to your culture. So how are we going to do that? But how do we don't not become so well adjusted to our culture. This is what we do. We instead, you fix your attention on God. You see, the minute we change our focus and fix our attention on God, things are going to change in our life. There's hope. But not only is there hope for our life, that things start to change. And today, you may need to get some things changed in your life. Maybe there's some circumstances or things that you can't get through in your life, and maybe you feel like there's some things that you just hit the wall against, and there's no, doesn't seem to be hope or solution, a solution to your situation. I want to tell you right now, when you turn your attention and you fix your attention on God, things start to change because He rescues His children. Amen. You know what happens is your perspective starts to change. And look what it says, when you start to fix your attention on God, this is the result. You'll be changed from the inside out. You're going to be changed from the inside out, not from the outside in, but God wants to change you from the inside out. God wants to do a work in you. He doesn't only want to do a work around you. He wants to do a work on the inside of you, and He wants to strengthen you for what's around you. You see, when God does a work on the inside of you, you're able to face whatever comes around you. And He strengthens you for that. Amen. It changes your perspective. And sometimes I realize is that we just need a change of perspective. Because sometimes we get so caught up in the life that we live in, and we get so focused on maybe what's not working and what's not going right. But you know what starts to happen is when you change your perspective and you start to fix your attention on God, God starts to speak into your life. And then suddenly you start to get hope. And suddenly you start to get a better future that you can see for your life. Suddenly when you fix your attention on God, you realize that God's in control of my life. And if God's in control of my life is going to be okay. I may not be happy with where I am, but I know that because God's in control and I'm fixing my attention on Him, He's going to do a work on the inside out. Readily recognize what He wants from you. God wants to do great things in you and quickly respond to it. Unlike the culture around you, always dragging you down to its level of immaturity, God brings the best out of you, develops well-formed maturity in you. And that's God's plan. God's plan is for Him to bring the best out of you, that you would flourish and walk in maturity with Him. The reality is this, is that culture always changes, but God never changes. So if we're basing our life on culture, our life is going to be continually up and down with culture. But when we focus and fix our attention on God, we can relate to culture, but we're not dragged down by culture. And so I want to encourage us, let's fix our eyes on God. We need to realize that God doesn't change. And one of the greatest things that we can realize is that our God never changes. His kindness, His mercy, His goodness, His promises, His faithfulness, His mercy, His compassion, His love, it never changes. It's a sure foundation for your life. And you need to now listen, they've done studies. They've proved this, is that one of the greatest needs that humanity has is stability. One of the greatest things that humanity, one of the greatest needs that they have to feel secure in their life is to know that they have a stable future. And there's no better foundation to build your life on than God's word. Because look what it says here in Psalm 40 verses 2. It says, He lifted me out of the pit of despair, out from the bog and the mire. And some of us, I want to say, sometimes we go through life and we could be in that situation right now. You could be feeling like, I'm in a pit of despair. I feel like I don't know how I'm going to get through. I feel like, and you know what happens when despair comes in? You start to experience discouragement. And when you start to feel discouragement, you know what you know? You're disconnected from courage. And God doesn't want you to be disconnected. He wants you to be all in, amen? He wants you to be connected. And so He says, He lifts me out of that, and He says, and He set my feet on a hard, firm path and steadied me as I walked along. That's what God wants to do today. He wants to lift you up. He wants to bring you up of where you are. And He wants you to be stable in Jesus' name. Amen. And so this morning, what I want to do is, in my series, last week we spoke about unusual habits. This week, I want to speak about unusual Christianity. Unusual Christianity. And the reason I want to speak about unusual Christianity is because when you say the word Christian, it evokes all sorts of different emotions. And everybody has a different view of what Christianity should be. They come to their own conclusion of what Christianity should be. If you ask people out there who are not Christians, what do they think about Christianity? There's a whole myriad of opinions of what Christianity is. And I really want to say this, is Christianity is not about perfection. Christianity is about the perfect one, and His name's Christ. Okay? And so the word Christianity is simply the beliefs and the practices based on the teachings and the person of Jesus Christ. That's Christianity. And the word Christianity comes from the word Christian. It comes from the word Christian. And the word Christian comes from the word Christ. And the word Christ means the Messiah, the Anointed One. Christ, the Anointed One. That means Christian are little anointed ones. You're little anointed one. What does the anointing do? Okay, anointing, if you're new to church, is a theological word. And the anointing is the power of God to do what God calls you to do. The anointing breaks the yokes over our life. So we are, a Christian is a little anointed one. So when you go out, and I go out into our workplaces, we go out and live in our life, we don't go out as ordinary people. We go out as little Christ. So like my kids, when they grew up, there used to be this program, Grandpa in My Pocket. Like if you got kids, you'll know exactly what that program used to drive me crazy. It was a little grandpa. He used to walk around on the, and it was crazy. And the kids would pick up this little grandpa and put them in their top pocket. And they'd walk around with Grandpa in My Pocket. Well, the Christianity, Christ, is Christ in you. Wherever I go, I am a little anointed one. Christ in me. And I can experience the breakthroughs, and I can live the life that God is calling me to live. Amen? And so the reason why I want to talk about unusual Christianity is because just under 80% of South Africans believe that they are Christian. Like most people, they believe that they are Christian, and a high percentage of that 80% are comfortable with the title but don't want the lifestyle. And so it's like, God, I believe God, what God is wanting to do in the church is he wants us to say, okay, well, if we're Christianity, if unusual Christianity means, what does it mean? It means to follow the teachings and the person of Jesus. And so I want to bring hope and encouragement to us because it changes our life. And when we're gathered together, we are individually Christ followers, but we're also the church. And the church, the word church is the Greek word ekklesia. And the word ekklesia means called out ones. So that we're being called out by God to be his witness on this earth, amen? And so what makes Christianity so powerful, what makes it so powerful is that it opposes our natural way of living. It opposes our natural default of doing things, our natural way of responding to life and to life's challenges. And in Jesus, in Matthew chapter 5 up to chapter 7, now I'd love you to take the time and read that passage in your quiet time. Read the word of God in your quiet time because it will change your life. And in Matthew chapter 5, verses 7, Jesus comes and he speaks to his disciples and he does a teaching which is called the Beatitudes. And that Beatitude, I call it the to be attitude, because that's the attitude God's calling us to live in, the to be attitude, okay? And so in Matthew chapter 5, he starts to, in verses 38, he starts to explain to his disciples and to people who are Christ followers how the kingdom of God works and how it opposes the world system. And it says here, you have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person. That's hard. Like when somebody does something to me, I want to get revenge. But God says, no, don't resist that person. He says, if anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to them the other cheek also. And if anyone wants to sue you and take your shirt, hand over your coat as well. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with them 2 miles. Give to the one who asks you, and do not turn away from the one who wants to borrow from you. You have heard that it was said, love your neighbors and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. He causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good, and he sends the rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. But if you love those, come on, I think God is speaking to all of us right now. He says, if you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And the tax collectors are like the worst people in town in Jesus' day. And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? Do not even pagans do that? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. You see, Jesus is explaining that the kingdom of God is gonna challenge us. And he paints a picture of what it means to be that. And it looks different. And it's challenging to our own personal life. It's unusual. It's unusual to pray for people. It's unusual to say, God, would you bless the person who's come up against me? It's, will you, Lord, I pray you bless my boss right now in Jesus' name. Jesus says, no, that's what you're going to do. It's unusual, but what it is, it's going to change you and it's going to change the world. It's going to change the world because Jesus was saying, when you come into me, I didn't come to fix a system that was broken. I came to bring in a brand new system. And that system is going to change. The system I'm talking about is the kingdom of God, and it's going to change everything about our life. And unusual Christianity is a decision. Listen, I want to say this. It's unusual for people to follow Jesus wholeheartedly. It's unusual. But when we start to do that, we're going to see what God can do in our life. You see, because we pursue the miracles, we pursue the blessing and the provision, and God has all of that. But it comes with an unusual commitment and devotion to following Him. And so what happens is Jesus is teaching His disciples this, and He says, I've come to bring in a new system. And you're new in Christ. When you came to Christ Jesus, God didn't come to do a repair work to your old life. In actual fact, He came to bring you a brand new life, a new day, new mercies, new opportunity, new blessing, forgetting what happened in your past. Even as a believer, even if you've been following Jesus for 20 years, every day is a new day. And every day has new blessing. It has new possibility. The challenge is when we carry over what happened yesterday into our new day, we don't live the new possibilities that God has for us. And so it says here in 2 Corinthians 5:17, if anyone is in Christ, that means that you just believe in Jesus Christ. He's your Lord and Savior. If anyone is in Christ, that is grafted in, joined to Him by faith in Him as a Savior, he is a new creature, reborn and renewed by the Holy Spirit. The old things, the previous moral and spiritual condition, have passed away. Behold, new things have come, because a spiritual awakening brings a new life. A spiritual awakening brings a new life. And this is what made the early church so powerful, is that they took on this new way of living. And they took away on this new life that God had come through to, and sent through His Son Jesus. And they woke up every day saying, you know what, today is a new day. That what God wants to do today, it can be uniquely different to what happened in my yesterday. It can be. And what happened was they started to believe in that new day that God had given them, and they started to take on the teachings of Jesus. And you know what, it didn't make sense to the world. It didn't make sense to the world that Christians, that these people would do everything that Jesus did, and it directly opposed the world system, the Roman Empire. And because of that, they never understood it. And they never maybe even believed in it. But what they could not dispute was its power and how it brought change. And I want to encourage us this morning that God wants to do exactly that through the church today. That God wants to bring hope, and He wants to bring change, and He wants to use the church. In fact, the government is not going to change this country. I want to say right now, the world powers are not going to heal the economic recession. Only God can do that, and He does it through the church. The only hope for society and humanity is Jesus Christ delivered through the church. And then I want to encourage us this morning, let us live our life and follow Christ and live our life in an unusual way. Be an unusual Christian. When you leave church this morning and you get caught up in the car park and you're tempted to cut in and ride over the car park people, you're going to be unusual and say, you first. Come on. Listen, we get reports every week of what happens. I'm going to be unusual. I'm going to be unusual. I'm going to have an unusual commitment. I'm going to have unusual devotion to God. I'm not going to be dragged down by everything that's happening around me. I'm going to be lifted up because His ways are higher than my ways. And His thoughts are higher than my thoughts. I want to be unusual. And so when this happened, they had so much power. And so much power that they started to become a threat. And I love what C.S. Lewis says. He says, my prayer is when I die, that all hell rejoices because I'm out of the fight. Come on. I mean, that's powerful, man. I want to be that person. Like, we're so glad He's gone to be with the Lord, because He was an obstacle in our way. Come on. And so what is this society being a Christian, in this society being a Christian, I think that sometimes it's like a fashion statement. It's accepted broadly to say that I'm a Christian. But it's interesting to know that the early church wasn't known as Christians. The early church were known as believers of the way. They were known as believers of the way. The name Christian was a condescending name that was given to them by the world. Because they looked at them and they said, "Are you like Christ? You're like that guy who came with the funny teachings, told us to live." And so the word Christian actually is a condescending word. But we are Christ followers, amen? And we are believers of the way. And so I want to say, how do we live? And just give you a few points on how do we live this unusual Christianity. I firstly believe that it starts with building our lives on the teachings of Jesus. Is that you've got to build your life on God's word. Jesus said, look what he said in John 6:63. He said, "The words that I speak to you are spirit and they are life." So when we take the teachings of Christ and follow him, we're going to experience the life that God has. When we build our life on God's word, it's going to bring life and direction into our lives. You see, God's word has the power to change your life. It not only has the power to change your life, it has the power to set you free, amen? And so I really believe that you can't be all that God has called you to be without his word. But you can be all that God's called you to be if you're in his word. And so I want to encourage us that we build our lives on the teachings of Christ Jesus. Joshua 1:8 says that the book of law, speaking about God's word, will not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your ways prosperous, and then you will have good success. So what God is saying is that when you take my word and you build your life on my word, and you start to spend time in my word, and you start to think and meditate on my word, what's going to start to happen is it's going to start to bring some change, and your way is going to become prosperous and successful. And many of us, we want successful, and God's plan for your life is to be successful. But it starts with meditating on his word. Meditate, the word meditate is a word, a Hebrew word, which is ruminate, which really means to chew on, to ponder, and to think upon, and re-chew, and just continually speak it out and study it, amen? Because the truth is this, is that what you meditate on will become your action. So whatever I'm thinking, my thoughts, and what I'm thinking about all the time is going to lead me into a specific action and direction for my life. And so we want to do that, and we realize that God's word is powerful for our life. Now we want to realize that God has given us the Bible, and the Bible is his weapon for you and I to overcome in life. In actual fact, there is no greater weapon for you to overcome and get breakthrough in your life than the word of God. You take one scripture from God's word, you find a situation that you're challenged in your life. I can tell you now, you take one scripture and you start meditating on that scripture, that I'm an overcomer. I'm an overcomer. When I'm feeling down, I'm an overcomer. When I'm feeling discouraged, I'm an overcomer. When the enemy comes against me, I'm an overcomer. I meditate and I start thinking. And you know what starts to happen? I start to behave in that way. And I start to experience God's word in my life. Look what it says in Hebrews 4:11. It says, "For the word of God is alive and active." Come on, it's alive. I mean, it's not a book of rules. It's alive. It has the power to bring transformation into your life. The Bible says it's the word of God is alive and it's active. It's sharper than any double-edged sword, and it penetrates even to dividing the soul and the spirit, joints and marrow, and it judges the thoughts and the attitudes of the heart. Listen, it's a weapon against the enemy. We take this weapon whenever the enemy comes up and he brings thoughts or discouragement or whatever he brings into our life. We take the word of God. It's our weapon. We stand with the weapon. As a believer, you need a weapon because you have an enemy. And God says, I've given you the weapon. You don't have to make your own weapon. You just got to take my word. My word is a weapon that will destroy whatever the enemy brings against you, whatever's coming against your life. In this Bible, in this book, you have a weapon that can destroy anything that comes to attack the plan and purposes of God in your life. It's a weapon. You know, you'll never go into a battle without a weapon. In fact, the guys in the South, they don't even go to the shops without a weapon. But we're living this life called of God, purposed by God. God's got a great plan and a future for your life. But yet we go into battle and we leave the weapon behind. And many people get injured in the battle because they don't have the weapon. But the weapon is not only to destroy the enemy, the weapon is to bring healing into your life. Because it divides and it separates and it shows truth. You build your life on God's word. This is what the early church did. They followed the teachings of Jesus, and no one could convince them any other way that, no, this is the way we are to live. This is what God has called us to. And because of that, as a result of them following the teaching of Christ, they had power. So when they laid hands on the sick, people got healed. In actual fact, in Acts chapter 4, says that they were so full of God's word and power that the people said, we just want to get the people in the shadow of Peter and the disciples. And they walked past and they got healed. They didn't even touch them. Why? Because they lived in an unusual way. And God's calling us as a church not to be spooky and freaky, but just to live in an unusual way. And it is spooky and freaky to the usual. And so we live in God's word, amen? We trust in God's word. The second way that we're going to live this unusual, you cannot live this unusual life without the fuel of the Holy Spirit. You see, the church was fueled by the Spirit of God. And the Spirit of God always brings life. And I want to say today, if your Christianity and your relationship's dry with God, maybe it's just a season you're going through, because sometimes we go through seasons, but there's one thing that can get it up on fire again, and that's being filled with the power of the Spirit of God. We need the Spirit of God. You'll never accomplish all that God's called us to without His Spirit, without His power, without His anointing on our life. The Spirit of God always brings life. Without the Spirit of God, preaching is boring. Church is boring. Without the Spirit of God, the Word of God is just knowledge. But with the Spirit of God, it brings life change. The Holy Spirit, you know what He does? He starts to convict us. Because God loves us. And so when God starts to challenge you about your personal lifestyle and personal issues, it's because He loves you and the Spirit of God is alive on the inside of you. And He's calling you. He's like, no. This is what my word does. Is it's a weapon to destroy the enemy, but it's also going to be a scalpel that's going to try and cut out some sin in your life. And we need the Spirit of God. Without the Spirit of God, we cannot do anything. And so when the Spirit of God comes upon you, it changes you, it sets you free, and it empowers you to be all that God has called you to be. Jesus, this is what I realized, is that Jesus gave them purpose, but before their purpose was accomplished, they needed power. And God's given you, each and every single one of us, purpose, but we need His power to accomplish that purpose. And Jesus gave them the Great Commission, and He said, this is what the church is called to do. The church, every single one of us here in this building, we're called to do this. Go into the world and preach the gospel, tell people about Jesus, teach Him His ways, and make disciples. And Jesus said, go into the world, and lo and behold, I'm with you till the end. But you know what? They could only go once they received the power. And you know what happens when you receive God's power? You're going to get boldness on your life. And some of you, you're just one step away from reaching into your divine destiny and divine calling. And all you need is God's Spirit to activate something on the inside of you and bring life into you that's going to give you the boldness. I believe God wants to do that in your life this morning. But look what it says in Acts chapter 1. It says, but you will receive power. Everybody say power. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses, telling people about me everywhere, in Jerusalem, throughout Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. You see, when God's Spirit comes upon us, He empowers us to fulfill the call that He's put on our life. And in Acts chapter 4, verses 31, look what it says. And after this prayer, and they were praying in a place, it says the meeting place shook, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they preached the word of God with boldness. I want to tell you right now, when God's Spirit comes upon you, you get a boldness inside of you. You're not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You realize that it's the gospel of Jesus Christ that gives me the power unto salvation. And I want to encourage you, some of you, you just need a little bit of boldness. Today you got to ask God, would you fill me up with your Spirit once more time? Because in the book of Acts, they never got filled once, they got filled continually. And it says that they were filled with the Spirit. And when they were filled with the Spirit, they had great boldness. Peter was shy, timid before Jesus went to the cross. But after the cross, he came out with boldness because the Spirit of God was upon him. Third thing is this, unusual Christianity always pursues cause over comfort. Let me say that again because you went quiet. It always pursues the cause of Christ over my personal comfort. And sometimes when God challenges you and He's drawing you and He's beckoning you closer, when you're following God in an unusual way, what you do is you surrender your will. You see, what you do is you say, God, I surrender my will, my agenda, and I take on your will, your agenda. Let your kingdom come, let mine be gone. And so this is what happens, is when we do that, we experience God in a great and mighty way. And that what you're saying is, Lord, my life is not about me, it's about pursuing you. You see, I really believe that one of the most frustrating ways to live as a believer is to never see God answer any of your prayers and just never see breakthrough in every area of your life. And the truth is, God wants to bring all of that. God wants to bring all of that. But what we do is we need to pursue his cause above our comfort. And whenever we pursue his cause above our comfort, that means, you know what it means? God, I'm going to pursue building your church, building your kingdom here on this earth. So on an overcast day, I'm preaching to the people that are not right here. So it's cool. You guys are the ones that are pursuing the cause. Because how many of you know, today would have been an awesome day to sit at home in under the blankets. But you know what you chose to do? I chose to pursue the cause of Christ. I realize that my eternal salvation and my earthly life is dependent on God's word. It's pursuing. It's saying, God, I put you first. I take your cause. Amen. And so God wants to bring maturity and he wants to bring growth into your life. God's plan for your life is that next year, this time, you're going to be a totally different person to what you are this year. So that's God's plan and purpose. But what do? We've got to pursue the cause of Christ. And so there's three things that we've got to ask ourselves. And I've been asking our team this. I've been asking myself this. There's three questions you've got to ask yourself if you're going to grow and mature in God. Number one, what is the one thing that I need to add to my life in order for me to grow? What is the one thing that I need to add in my life? Maybe I need to add some new connections. Maybe I need to add some more time praying. Maybe some more time in God's word. Maybe more time serving, volunteering. Maybe more time worshiping God. There's one thing that there's something that I need to add to my life that's going to grow me. Then what is the thing that you need to subtract from your life? Because there's things in our life that maybe there's just one thing, one or two things that we need to subtract in our life. Maybe it's a secret sin. Maybe it's a habit. Maybe it's a negative mindset. Maybe it's doubt. Maybe it's just your connections. There's maybe one or two people that you need to, like, you know what, these people are not going to take me to my core. What is the one thing that you need to subtract from your life? And then the third question is this, is what is the one thing that God needs to do that only God can do? And we're going to start asking those questions. We're going to start seeing some change in our life. Amen. Is this helping you this morning? Okay, because you know what happens when you start living for the cause of Christ? You're going to live in the stretch. And God's calling you to stretch. God's not interested in our comfort. I want to say this right now. God's interested in your purpose. He's interested in the plan that he has for your life. And that plan and purpose is always going to cause you to stretch beyond your own ability. But it's in the stretch that we see his goodness. It's in the stretch that we see his grace. It's in the stretch that we see growth. And so God is calling you and I to live in this stretch. Live in the stretch. So God's going to say to you, you know what, Donavan, I need you to do this. And it's going to be so uncomfortable. It's going to be so uncomfortable. He might even say to you, that family member that's been speaking bad about you, I want you to pick up the phone and I want you to phone them and ask them how they're doing. I'm going to stretch you because I'm interested in your growth. Come on, church, don't go quiet on me, please. This is in the Bible. But God wants to stretch us. And listen, I want to say right now, if you're not stretched, you're not living in faith. Because when you're stretched, you need faith to believe that God is going to make up the difference. And God will always make up the difference when you are living in the stretch. He will never let you down. Oh God, this is what you've called me to do. No, 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 this is what you're settling for. God has called you to do great and mighty things. God has called you to experience infinitely more than you could ever ask or imagine. But in order to get that, you got to stretch, baby. You got to stretch. And you don't grow when you're not stretched. Because when you're not stretched, you're living in fear because you're scared it's going to not work out. And God said, I will never leave you. And I haven't given you a spirit of fear. I've given you a spirit of power, love, and a sound mind. So stretch yourself. Get out of the comfort. The comfort's not going to change you. The stretch is going to grow you. The last thing is this, as the worship team comes up, is that unusual Christianity, you're always going to experience unusual breakthrough. Unusual breakthrough. I love this fact is that many people want the breakthrough, but they don't want the unusual lifestyle. And when you start living the unusual lifestyle, you're going to experience unusual breakthrough. There's people on our team, I can tell you right now, they're like so favored of God. I'm telling you, they are so favored of God. There's so many people in our church, they just experience God's favor. But when I look at their life, the reason they experience the favor is because they're living in an unusual way. Because they haven't been dragged down by the culture. Oh, I'm tired. I don't feel like worshiping today. No. The early church, they whipped them. They beat them. 39 stripes. Scientifically proven that if they had been lashed one more time, they would have died. 39, thrown in a jail. You know what their response was? We're going to praise God. That's unusual. It's like my whole world has just collapsed. And I love Wayne and Wendell today. And a shout out to them today because their cousin was in a horrific accident. But today they're in church lifting their hands. They're worshiping God. Because it's unusual. Because you know what happens in our life? And I'm not underplaying your sensitivity and the hard things you go through in life. But sometimes we allow life's things to be bigger than our God. And God's calling us. And you want to experience unusual breakthrough. I want to tell you, God can bring it into your life. He can bring it into your life. But it starts with just pursuing Him. So I'm taking the teachings of Jesus. And I'm going to follow them. Look what it says here, Acts chapter 16, around midnight, Paul and Silas were praying. You see, they put them in prison because they were teaching God's word. And they were praying and singing hymns to God. And the other prisoners were listening. Suddenly, there was a massive earthquake. And the prisons were shaken to its foundations. And all the doors immediately flew open. And the chains of every prisoner fell off. And the jailer woke up to see the prison doors wide open. And he assumed the prisoners had escaped. So he drew his sword to kill himself. God has just given them this amazing breakthrough. I want to say right now is that when you're going through your deepest pain, you can experience your greatest breakthrough. But your way to your greatest breakthrough is not conforming to what the world prescribes. Your greatest way to your breakthrough is saying, God, even if I'm in a prison right now, I'm going to praise you. I'm going to praise you. I'm going to praise you. Even when my bank account does not line up with your promises, I'm lifting my hands and I'm tithing and I'm worshiping you. Even if my body feels sick, God, I lift this hand. You created this body so you can heal this body. So I offer it in an unusual way right now in a sign of worship. God, I thank you, Lord. Unusual Christianity. Unusual. It's unusual. God's called you to be unusual. So He can do unusual things through you. In Jesus' name. Come on, let's bow our heads. Amen. Come on, let's give God one more praise. One more praise. Come on, give Him your best. Now, before you bow your heads, I just want to speak to us as a church and then we'll just close up. The most crazy thing that ever happened in humanity is that humanity sinned. And fell short of meeting God's standard. Totally fell short. Every single one of us, we were born sinners because of Adam. Okay? That's a big theological thing that happened in the Garden of Eden. And because of one man's sin, every single one of us were born into sin. Cannot change that. It's just how it happened. So because one man had caused all men to sin, God needed one man to redeem all men from sin. And that man is Jesus. And today, Jesus came into this world and He died on a cross for each and every single one of us so that we would not be conformed and that we would not be enslaved to sin, that we would not be enslaved to the world system, but we'd be set free. Unusual joy, unusual happiness, unusual peace only comes through one person, and that's Jesus. And today, you and I, been given the opportunity to have a relationship with this God, Jesus. So I want to ask you right now, won't you bow your heads? And while every head's bowed and every eye's closed, you haven't made Jesus Christ the Lord and Savior of your life. I want to tell you right now that you can do that today because God loves you with an unconditional love. You can live your life. You can experience an unusual life in Christ Jesus. And so you'd say, Donavan, you know, I don't know Jesus as my personal Lord and Savior. Jesus came freely to give His life. Freely. It's a free gift. Salvation is a free gift. You don't have to work for it. You don't have to pay for it. You don't have to earn it. You just got to receive it. It's God's goodness because God is a good God. And so you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior. And today you'd say, you know, I want to accept Jesus as my Lord and Savior. I've never committed my heart and my life to Him. I know about Him. I've heard about Him. I've been to church. But I don't have that personal relationship. You'd say, you know what, that's me. I want to ask you on the count of three, won't you just raise your hand where you are? God loves you today. One, the Bible says, for God so loved the world, He sent His Son Jesus to die for you. He loves you so much that He took your place. He paid for your sin. He loves you so much. Don't reject His love today. Two, His love is an unconditional love. Never changes. Never changes. God is love. And He loves you today. In spite of whatever's happened in your past, today's a new day in God's eyes for your life. Three, right now, if that's you, just raise your hand and I want to include you in that prayer. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Is anybody else that would say, yes, thank you, I see your hands. Just raise your hands up high, please, if you don't mind. If you raised your hand, won't you just keep it up high wherever you are? We just want to include you in a prayer. Maybe today you're in a situation where you know you need to recommit your heart to God. Thank you. You can put your hands down. You need to recommit your heart to God. And you want to get your life back on track. And you want to start experiencing the unusual power of God in your life, the unusual blessing and favor of God on your life. Today it's freely available. And you say, you know what, Donavan, I need to get my life back right with God today. Well, I want to invite you today to make that decision and just say, God, I recommit my heart to You. I come back to You today. Today it's going to be a new start again. It's going to be a new beginning for me. I want to serve You, God. I want to love You, God, like You love me, Lord, in the way I used to serve You. If that's you, won't you just raise your hand, and I want to include you in that prayer right now. Thank you. I see your hand. Just raise your hands up high. Please, won't you just keep them up high so we can just count you in on this prayer. If that's you, just raise your hand. Is anybody else that would say, yes, that's me? God loves you this morning. He's not angry with you. You may have gone away for a season. And today you've come back. Experience His goodness. He loves you. You can raise your hand and I'll include you in that prayer. Thank you. You can put your hands down. Let's pray this prayer together. Now as I pray this prayer, I want to ask you, won't you just repeat these words after me as I pray? Every single person who raised their hand, you can just repeat these words. And if you didn't raise your hand, won't you just repeat these words? The rest of our church, we're going to lead you. Father God, I thank You right now for sending Your Son Jesus, who died on the cross for me and has forgiven me of all my sins. I accept You, Lord Jesus, as my Lord and Savior today. I ask You to come and live inside me. And I give You my life today. Thank You for forgiving me of all my sins and for giving me a brand new start. I commit my life to You today. And I follow You, Jesus, all the days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Come on, let's give those people a great hand.